Good evening, and thank you for coming to our third Noise Scholars Colloquium this semester. This is the third in our series of four for the semester. Our final talk will be on April 29th, and that's going to be given by Deepak Basu, talking about his daughter's career in science, and that will be here in this room at 6 p.m. as well, so you might want to save the date for that one. For tonight, though, I have the pleasure of introducing a friend and colleague from Bryn Mawr College, Victor Donnay, who is coming to us from the Department of Mathematics. He's professor of mathematics and received the 2013 AMS Award for Exemplary Achievement for success in encouraging women students to study mathematics, which is exciting.
Wasn't me, it was our whole math department.
And in addition, his research is on chaotic dynamical systems, which I know nothing about, but you'll hear a little bit about, I'm sure, tonight.
We like chaos.
Sometimes. Not necessarily in classrooms. And but tonight we're here to learn more about math and sustainability. So as you see, the room is not set up in its usual state. We're going to be working in groups, and this is going to be a little bit of a hybrid talk and workshop. So it should be a lot of fun, and from here I'm just going to turn the floor over.
Great.
Thank you, Lisa. Well, it's a great pleasure to be here. I'm the PI of Bryn Mawr's Noise Scholarship Program. So I'm excited to be here with Noise Scholars and talk about teaching. So probably for the last 10 or 12 years, my main focus has shifted from math and chaos theory to math and science education. I teach a course called Changing Pedagogies in Math and Science Education at Bryn Mawr every other year, which is about kind of the new approaches to teaching, hands-on learning, inquiry learning, what does learning theory tell us about how people learn, and how can we use that in our teaching. And the second part of that little title, Changing Pedagogies, is how can one bring about change in school systems that are more old-fashioned and haven't learned about these new approaches, and then, heaven forbid, all the standardized testing we have to deal with that gets in the way of all of that. So, you go to a talk on like new approaches in math teaching and they just lecture at you. So we're not gonna do that. We're gonna have kind of this interactive, hands-on stuff, and we'll get started. What are some issues facing the world and the nation that you are concerned about? So sometimes you'll be students, and then we'll kind of do a debrief, and we'll be kind of educators. So now you're a student. This is how I begin every one of my math courses. And in your groups of three or four, I want you to follow instructions and answer the questions. So you'll have a couple minutes in your groups to work on that. And then you'll report out what you came up with. Okay, I'm going to give you about 2 minutes now to make your list. So it's kind of speed. Okay, we'll do report outs now. If there's still things you'd like to add to the list, we'll kind of get a free-for-all at the end where you can toss out more things. So what we're going to do is also a way to introduce you to me, so you know a little bit about me. I'd like to know kind of who you are. So we'll just kind of go around, say your name, kind of why you're here. Like, I'm guessing many of you are in math or science education, so say if you're in math or science or anything else about why you're here at our talk tonight, and then give one problem from your list, your group's list, facing the world.
Right. My name is Corey McCammon. I'm taking this class. I'm in the education program here, and I'm specifically looking to focus on math and science, actually, both of them together. The problem that I came up with was solving world hunger.
Great. My name is Lily Benchu, and I'm a transfer student from France, and I'm a math major. So, and one of the main issues that we all came up with, actually, was inequality.
I think the math people would approve of that. That's an important problem, inequality.
Hi, I'm Lisa, and I'm a sophomore at Barnard, and I am a psych major, and I'm very interested in math education and how the brain processes math and like different people. And one of the issues
issues I put down was involving like schools and the education system. I think standardized testing, as you mentioned before, is a really, really big problem that we have here.
Hi, I'm Audrey. I'm going to secondary science education, and the big problem I contributed to loom over us was global warming.
I am Lisa Edstrom, and I'm here to teach the course.
Or let you stay.
But also because I'm interested. I contributed oil shortage to our list of problems.
I'm Manuela Albier. I'm also in Professor Estrom's course, and I came up with also World Hunger.
And math, science, both?
Comparative literature, French and Italian.
And why are you in a course in science education then?
Well, I'm actually very interested in teaching, so that's why I'm in the course.
Great. Well, it's great that someone who's not in math and science is here for our theme.
I'm an environment economics major, and I'm here because I co-directed a summer program at Barnard, Law Summer for Women in Entrepreneurship, and realized I didn't know anything about teaching. And I put global poverty.
Dave, I'm in the math department at Barnard, and I wonder when we solve all these energy problems, what fuel airplanes are going to use in the future.
Hi, I'm Paula. I'm a sophomore at Barnard, and I am currently applying to the education program. I put wastefulness in society.
What was it?
Wastefulness.
And math, science?
I'm not doing art this year.
Oh. I'm Alana. I'm an economics major. I'm taking a course because I'm really interested in sort of education policy. And I contributed, I think, pollution.
I'm Kavi, I'm a sophomore at Barnard in pre-med, but I'm also majoring in neuroscience. I'm minoring in econs. I'm also really interested in educational policy, and that's why I'm here. And the problem I contributed was healthcare accessibility.
I'm Hillary Callahan, and I'm a professor in biology here at Barnard. I teach about ecology, which is very quantitative. And I added, I think this is damage to the soil.
Maria Rivera, I'm in education here, and science education. And I think we put a lot of things on this list. I probably would put down of things I've contributed. Let's see. Well, we said poverty. That's like, that was my number one. And then I would probably add education as number two, just all the rules and all the top-downness that I want to get rid of, have more bottom-upness.
Great. Other things that we haven't mentioned yet that you had on your list that you'd like us to know about?
You mentioned genocide.
Genocide?
Terrorism. Yeah, safety and security.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Others?
Corrupt governments.
In New York, expect that. You have that in Philadelphia. Others? Okay, well, that was a good list. Let me do this. So the goal of our math lesson here today is to see how these issues you care about connect to mathematics. And so this is how I now begin every one of my math courses, with exactly this exercise, saying that the goal of our math course is to see how mathematics that we learn in the course can connect to these issues you care about. Why do I do that? Because to have students learn, they need to be motivated. And without that, I'm doing all this work and kind of pulling them along, versus if they can get excited about learning, then they do all the work and they learn much better. And I think there's neuro research that shows the brain works differently when somebody's kind of engaged in thinking and synapses happen and stuff. And this particular way of doing it, I learned about from the book, What the Best College Teachers Do. And it also is like for any teacher. And there was a great little story in there about the anatomy professor, two professors. One comes in the first day of class and says, we're going to learn about anatomy. It's kind of boring. It's all this memorization. We're just going to slog through it, and I'll do the best I can to try to make it interesting. The other professor comes in and says, I know many of you are pre-med and are going to be doctors. One day you're going to be in an emergency room, a patient is going to come in, you're going to have 2 minutes to diagnose what their problem is or they die. That is what this course is about. Which of those approaches would can be more captivating for your students?
Depends on the handle stress.
So then they encourage to paint the biggest picture you can about what your topic is about that you're teaching in as many different ways as you can, because different things excite students in different ways. And so since I don't know what excites my students, I ask them to tell me. And then I kind of promise, and in math it's actually true, a lot of these things that you have mentioned, we can touch upon in some way or other in a math class. It's a little like being on a high wire. You're never quite sure if you'll be able to do it, but a lot of it comes up. So here's kind of a little philosophy about this. Can we have a volunteer to read this?
If you want to build a ship, don't drum up people to collect wood and don't assign them tasks and work, but rather teach them to long for the endless immensity of the sea.
So that's a quote kind of getting at this idea. And I guess it gets at this, people were concerned about education, about testing, about all the minutiae. This is what we want to do as educators, not prepare students for standardized tests. This is fine. I read this one, I like this one. This is William James Talks to Teachers, 1899. Kind of Victorian. Any object not interesting in itself may become interesting through being associated with an object in which an interest already exists. The two associated objects grow, as it were, together. The interesting portion sheds its quality over the whole, and thus things not interesting in their own right borrow an interest, which becomes as real and strong as that of any negatively interesting thing. What does he say there?
He likes to fool people.
So that if you can, if you're interested in one thing and you see how it connects to something else, that makes the other thing more interesting. So I'm interested in kind of dynamical systems in the environment, and I have students who were on a summer project about marshes. Well, we don't know about marshes, but if you can make a math model of marshes, then marshes suddenly become interesting. So now we're doing a project on marsh growth, and will marshes get overwhelmed by sea level, or can they continue to grow kind of as sea level rises? So I've kind of experienced that myself. So how can we help our students take what they're interested in and shine it on things maybe they're not so interested in, which for some of them hard to believe might be math or science? So my little take on it is to use sustainability as a topic that I think many of our students are interested in. It's interdisciplinary, so the economics, we have comparative literature. Yep. It's a topic that we can link with these other areas, history, social studies. We can work with teachers in other departments to work together, which is exciting as an educator. It's actually an authentic issue facing the world, maybe the biggest challenge humankind is facing. And as we'll see here today, you can link math and the basic lessons that are on kind of the Common Core standards to sustainability. And then you can go further besides just doing things in the classroom. This topic is something that students can do projects on. They could green the school or green the community and use their academic knowledge to make an impact on the world. And again, given the fact that we have this serious issue, we want to use all the enthusiasm, creativity, and energy of our students to start solving the problems. They can actually do a lot. Rather than just sitting there being passive recipients of our knowledge, they can start changing the world right now. The US Department of Education in the last 2 years has a new award, the Green Ribbon School Award, like the Blue Ribbon Award that they gave for top academic schools. This is for schools that do three things. They have kind of green operations and facilities. They have healthy things in the school, so healthy food, exercise, clean air for the students. And then they link academics to sustainability. So rather than just this being some wild idea that I've come up with. It's now the official Department of Education policy. So there's a big lever out there to support it. And then in the Common Core now, they're asking for more high-level thinking skills, one of which is math modeling, where you use math to study real-world problems. So sustainability is a great thing for that. So I'm just curious, have any of you had experiences with sustainability, in particular in some kind of educational setting?
I'm an environmental science major. So right now I'm in a class on bird and plant dynamics, and we go out and survey birds and plants and think about how land use affects that. So that's one example.
Great.
I majored in forestry, and so we've talked a lot about sustainability, how to sustain forests, and how to balance, you know, land use and forest health for all the benefits that it provides us.
Cool. I was at a meeting last summer, and I met the head of the Sustainability Institute for one of the native peoples in Wisconsin, and they manage their forest in a very sustainable manner, keeping track of how long the trees have been there so that they can continually renew it. And other groups now come to them to learn these sustainable practices. Another example?
When I was in fifth grade, my teacher was very into going green and sustainability. And we had this big garden outside that we made our year. And we just planted a lot of fruits and vegetables. And now it's like an ongoing project at my elementary school.
How did it work? Because in the summer, you're not there for things to kind of grow.
I'm not sure, but I feel like we all, it's a very small town, so I feel like the teacher is around who probably caught it.
Because when you do these projects, there are often challenges to make it work out.
Yeah.
I teach a class about plant evolution, and one of the big things we did is domestication of plants, and it's this big tension between like narrowing biodiversity, but also this human yearning to keep the diversity, and how there's this big tension in agriculture going back for thousands of years between those two sustainability issues. It's like genetic sustainability.
Yeah, diversity. And one of my colleagues from the City and Urban Planning Department says, sustainability is not new. It's like a hot buzzword, but the Romans built things much more sustainably 2,000 years ago than we do now. So here were examples, some of which were from kind of environmentally related courses where you might imagine you're talking about sustainability. Does anybody have an example of some course that wasn't like an environment course where you talked about these issues, where you did a project in it? So like your project, was it linked to a class?
Well, in fifth grade, we kind of had, it wasn't like you went to specific classes, it was just kind of the overall thing. So it was part of our science unit. And we just kind of did it when the weather was nice. We kind of go out and take care of the garden. Yeah.
I took a seminar last semester in social entrepreneurship. And we had a few classes dedicated to ways that businesses can be sustainable as a means of being social.
And the present definition of sustainability is kind of balancing three things. One is the environment. Two is economics, that you know, we need a system where people have work and can support themselves. And three is social issues, that if we are trying to create a world that will sustain itself, that we all want to live in, part of that is social equity and social justice and treating people fairly. And so sometimes there are trade-offs in a job, you know, are we paying people fairly? What rate can we pay people and the company doesn't go out of business? What kind of environmental practices can a company afford to do and still have its workers being employed? And so it's kind of figuring out the balance of those three issues in a way that the world can continue and we can continue to survive the sustainability. So our first lesson is about the Arctic sea ice. So these are lessons that I and other people have developed and they're on the Math Awareness Month website, and I'll tell you more about that in a bit. But here, you can all kind of do a little math. So I'll give you a couple minutes to kind of read through this little intro. Yeah, I think that's enough. Any extras? So let me just ask you here, you're reading a little bit, but what do people know about the issue of sea ice in the Arctic?
It's decreasing.
It's decreasing. Other things?
You want to know everything to ask Stephanie for a month.
Is she an expert on this issue?
I recently read a book about the history of the planet. I can't remember which way it goes, but when it goes through, when we go into ice ages and back out, I think it has more even weather tends to lead to ice ages. There's like all these different beats with how close we are to the sun and how tilted we are, and when the tilt is at the closest point as opposed to the average point. And I think it's more even summers and winters tends to have ice build up over hundreds of thousands of years.
So there have been over hundreds of thousands of years these cycles of sometimes there's more ice, sometimes there's less ice.
And I do remember reading that the dinosaurs used to huddle together when it got cold for warmth on the South Pole because it sometimes fell below freezing. So global warming is only bad for humans. It's not bad for the planet. The planet will do fine.
This might not be around. Other things people know about or have been hearing about the Arctic?
A couple of the worst case scenarios involve a particular area in Greenland and Antarctica that are could just fall into the ocean, the ice could slip and fall and then it would all melt, and that would create a much more rapid climate change scenario than just sort of steady melting.
Other things? How many people have been hearing, a bit in the news that stuff's going on in the Arctic? Mm-hmm. Everybody? Good. Oh.
It's expanded its territorial waters for when it's clear.
Oh, and there's all kinds of things going
even
on.
Even more reasons why we should worry about
there's natural resources under at the bottom of the ocean that now people might be able to get to, whether through more drilling or other things. So we see.
We don't believe in catastrophes. But things happen catastrophically, and when the ice melts, all the bog stuff there is going to let out a whole bunch of gas at once, and the world's going to lurch much more.
On September 19th, 2012, the National Snow and Ice Data Center declared the annual sea ice minimum, with the lowest extent of Arctic sea ice ever seen in the modern record.
I would almost argue that we might be entering into a new climate state. What is causing us to lose more of that winter ice cover every summer? Is it that you have these feedback processes starting to kick in? I mean, some argue that the ice is very thin anyway, so that it melts out easier in the summertime as well.
The white stuff that you can see in the middle of the ocean here is the ice that's over 9 years old. As you go up into the bluer shades, the ice gets younger and younger. And starting, you can see the date here, we're still in the 1980s. You can see how that thick ice is being driven right out into the Atlantic Ocean. There's less and less of the old ice now. We're here still in the 1990s. And as that AO continues to drive all the thick ice out of the Arctic Ocean, you see that we're left with less and less of it. Getting up into the 2000s now, the Arctic is mostly filled with much younger ice. As we get right up to the present day practically, and here we are today, basically you see that there's hardly any of that thick ice left.
The volume of ice at the pole naturally goes up in the winter and down in the summer, but it's been declining over the last 30 years. It's now at the lowest level since records began.
Estimates that the North Pole could be ice-free in summer in a few years contrast with the official view of the Met Office that the Arctic will not be completely free of ice before the summers of 2030. But it's the effect of losing all that white ice that matters. The polar ice cap acts as a giant parasol, reflecting sunlight back into the atmosphere in what's known as the albedo effect.
30 years ago, the ice looked like this. The Arctic ice covered 2% of the Earth's surface, reflecting most of the sun's rays. But half of that ice has now gone, and open water absorbs far more of the sun's energy.
The rays of the sun land on the bright white surface of the ice. Most of the energy is reflected back into space and the region stays cool. But when the ice retreats and melts, those rays fall on the darker surface of the ocean. That energy gets absorbed, warming the ocean, melting more ice. A vicious cycle then begins. What the scientists call positive feedback.
The graph on the top right there, what that talks about is Arctic sea ice volume. It shows this pretty long-term trend here. That long-term trend is down.
A lot of focus has been on the area of the ice and how much there is, but what's also been happening is a thinning of the ice. And so it's becoming more vulnerable in two different ways. This year, there's been mitigation of storms occurring, and storms start churning up the water, and that churns up the ice and breaks it up and again, makes it into smaller pieces and causes damage. So as you open it up and you have open water, which can bring heat to the surface by churning and mixing and everything else, you're presumably adding more energy to the atmosphere, and so you have more potential for storms. So this is a very interesting phenomenon that I think people haven't really thought much about.
There has been some research that suggests that storms have been more numerous and slightly more intense. And probably that's because the ice edge, as it moves northward, that ice edge is a big temperature discontinuity in the surface. And so just like storms like to ride along the Gulf Stream along the East Coast, they also like to ride along discontinuous temperature areas or big differences in temperature like we see at the ice edge.
Certainly the storm in early August helped to break up the ice in the Chukchi and East Siberian Sea. But yeah, where the ice had melted out anyways, probably, because it was already pretty thin. And there was a lot of open water areas already between the ice floes. So the storm just sort of took it away really quickly. I think it would have melted out anyways, though.
The amount of sea ice that was lost this year compared to any year we can look at going back even a couple thousand years. There's really nothing like what we've seen happen this year. This loss of sea ice this summer is just such a stunning example of how the climate system is changing right before our very eyes. I mean, this is something that anybody can see. You don't have to be a scientist. And I like to hope that if there's a silver lining in all of this, that it's helping people to wake up and realize that this is a big problem, this is a real problem, it's happening now, it's not happening generations from now, and that we need to really start doing something about it.
Was that the video?
No, I just saw some of the animations. Yeah, I think the age of the ice was the one that I had seen.
So that's kind of giving us some background about this issue. Thoughts as you watch the video?
New York needs floodgates and lots of weather mitigation measures.
So food for thought. Now we'll do a little math. This is our math lesson. So here are kind of two-sided thing. Maybe you have, if you have a calculator, that would be helpful. So you can pull one up from a laptop.
Oh, is that right?
Maybe I'll give you about 15 minutes to work on this. You probably can't get through all of it. There's some parts that you need to do a little research on, so just get started. And I don't want it too quiet. I want you to be chit-chatting with your team, what you're doing and how to do it. You can. Yeah, it's exponential decrease, but that's like decreasing really, really fast. Linear, great. you're remembering stuff from deep memories.
Yeah,
from
yeah.
So what are going to be the units of your slope?
Right, so.
And that's where you're wrong. What's your formula for slope? Okay, but if you right, and if how did you figure out the slope here?
Y2 minus Y1 over X2 minus X1.
Okay, so why don't you put that here?
Oh, so it's you just choose like kilometers over here.
No.
Yes. Or what exactly are the units on the top?
I don't like to imagine.
Right.
And then
how many kilometers square?
Million
kilometers square. Yes. Great. So this whole exercise could take quite a while, and in a classroom it could be even a several day exercise. Let me ask you to skip ahead, and on the second page they did an Excel fit, and if you want I can show you a little bit how one does that. That's what they came up with for their fit. And the question is, either with the slope you had or the one given there, in what year does it predict the Arctic will be ice-free? That in September, when things have melted as much as they do, when does it predict there'll be no ice left? So that's a question about how accurate is our model.
Well,
so
this
point.
Is saying open ice.
There's definitely a problem with the model, right? Because didn't they
good
say
point.
The
yeah.
more...
And once you've figured out that prediction of the year it will be ice-free, go back to number 5
so we're looking
and do that one also.
Oh, really?
Okay, let's do a little debrief on what went on.
That's all I know.
So that's actually an issue when one does this kind of thing. We want students to end. People were saying they feel kind of somber now and depressed. And so we want to kind of end with students feeling empowered to make a change rather than all depressed and hopeless. So we'll do a little thinking about, you know, what could we do to kind of turn it around. So in number one, say in September 2080, what was your answer?
Oh, wait,
number one.
Number one.
2008. 2008. What's the, how much ice was that? 2008.
About 4.7
million. 4.7
square kilometers.
Million square kilometers. Right. And what is the trend? Just basically negative going down. Good.
Okay.
What did you get in number two when you eyeballed it for the slope? What were some values? What did you have in your slope?
We got -1/12 of a million kilometers squared, which ended up being about 83,000.
83,000
yeah.
kilometers squared.
Yeah.
What were the units?
Kilometers squared per year.
Yes. Now, let me ask you to repeat what you said to me when I asked you about units.
Well, I originally thought there was no units for slope.
How many people had that idea that there were no units? Slope doesn't have a unit.
That's what I was thinking, and then I realized we're dealing with a real world context, and there's years and kilometers. And
so until about 3 years ago, I'm a math professor, I got my PhD about 30 years ago. Until 3 years ago, I did not realize slope had a unit. Because all the math I've ever done is X's and Y's that don't mean anything and don't have any units.
We know that.
And scientists, yes, scientists use units, and so when you get our math students, you say, well, why can't you do this? Because in math, we never do it. It's all this kind of more abstract stuff. So thank you for being honest and saying what so many math students have been trained into understanding, that slope doesn't have a unit, because we never use units, but here we see it does have a unit.
But then you can also rescale it, right? So, I kind of thought that was your question about the converting it to miles.
Right, you can
it's
change
still
units.
The same slope, But if you change the units, then
the number
changes. So you're using a different scale.
Right.
But you're actually still doing the same rate of change.
But it would have a different numerical value. Did anybody convert from the kilometers, square kilometers, into square miles?
We did, but I'm not sure it's entirely correct. Because we got 0.027 miles square per year.
So a little bit less.
Yeah.
So you would definitely.
So if you change it to miles, it sounds like suddenly the problem's not as serious.
Because it's not as much.
Yeah. Well, it depends on what your perspective is.
Right.
And then what was your comment, though,
about having
a square mile or a square
mile? I justified my own laziness by saying that the average, the way you phrased it, you said, understandable to the average citizen. So I said to the average citizen, a square kilometer and a square mile are both very abstract, so you don't really know what that means. And you said to do something like a football field. But then I looked up on the internet, like, what state is about the size of the annual losses?
Which we said is 80,000?
Yeah, because I found a table that did it in kilometers, square kilometers. So the area of South Carolina in square kilometers is about
what we're losing
82,000
82,000
square kilometers per year. So it's about one South Carolina per year.
Okay. Great.
Now that doesn't really mean anything.
Unless you
if you look at a map, then if you know a little bit of the geography, which you probably don't know either, but it's definitely people know that it's not one of the smallest states.
How many South Carolinas could we lose to take over?
How many Delawares could we lose?
How many Delawares?
Right. How many Delawares, right.
So that's a really great point that many of these units we don't have a gut feeling for, and maybe that's part of the problem that. It's so abstract. So
well, then it's like you created a new unit, and you kind of show that units are kind of arbitrary.
So. There's a great unit problem here. This is why we look at differences in the y values to fit that line. If you simply tried to draw as close as possible to the dots, you'd be subjected to the effect of units. Whereas if you do it by differences in y values, least squares of y values,
so
you get the same line when you change scale.
Right.
We do teach that in math.
I hear I'm ragging on math.
What?
I hear I'm ragging on math. My apologies for giving math a hard time. So that's an interesting whole bit, too, about how does one communicate these issues. And you say, why are we reading something in math? Why are we seeing a video in math? Why are we trying to communicate in math? We just like doing our X's and Y's in math. But that math is part of these bigger issues, and hopefully some of our students will get more interested in it as it actually gets harder, because they see kind of the relevance of how math can do it. So the one I like is math is about predicting the future. So in my math class, whenever we get to like a big point, I ask for a drum roll. So I will give you a drum roll because we're going to predict when will the Arctic be ice free. Well, what predictions did people come up with? The group over here, what was your prediction?
It was a little bit after 2068.
2068. How about there? Did you guys get an
estimate? 2036.
You came up with 2036, okay. And your group? What's your prediction?
With the present trend, we got 2045.
Yeah. And when you took the original trend, as compared to the one that got steeper? 2068. So that also gets at the issue of when we do a fit, there's actually different ways of doing a fit. You can do it over the whole region, but here it actually seemed to make more sense to do a couple different fits. Back here, maybe this was the fit, and then whoa, that's the fit.
That's a roller coaster.
And why, kind of physically, from what you've been reading about and hearing, why should that rate of change be kind of increasing? We're losing more and more ice every year.
There are these feedback loops.
Right. And what causes the feedback?
Because the sun is not, energy is not being able to be reflected by the light.
And so what happens to the energy from the sun rather than being reflected?
It's being absorbed.
being absorbed by the water. And so then it gets warmer, which causes more routes to mount, which causes it to get warmer. So that's kind of what I learned about in chaos theory and dynamical systems, where you have some system that's evolving according to a rule. And if the rule is springs bounce back and forth, one understands the rule very well. If the rules are how is the world's climate changing, then we don't understand it so well. But some of the principles that you learn in a very simple thing, I studied billiard ball systems, billiard balls bouncing around, actually one billiard ball, because it's too complicated with many, but you have different shaped regions. And in some regions, like a circle, you get a nice regular pattern, but if you cut the circle in half and put in straight lines, so it looks like a football stadium, then the pattern is very chaotic. And so the idea might be, if you change kind of the situation of the ice from more ice to less ice, then maybe our weather is going to go from being kind of regular to chaotic, or less kind of predictable. Like this winter, for example. And actually, people are wondering whether the decrease in ice is affecting the jet stream in some very complicated nonlinear way, which is actually the reason that our winter is colder this year and has more snow, because of the complicated interactions of all these pieces.
Well, I don't know, it's not the almanac got it right.
Did they?
They did. They predicted, the almanac predicted it was going to be the coldest, snowiest winter. It was.
So as a kind of a connection as an abstract theoretical mathematician is the things we might figure out for really simple systems like these billiard balls, but they're simple enough that we can prove rigorously. The applied scientist, the applied mathematician has those concepts, even if they can't make those rigorous proofs, to try to say, well, here we're having, we use the term tipping point or bifurcation. If we reach a certain level of ice melt, then maybe no matter what we're going to do in the next 20 years, it's going to melt. We've reached a point where we can't change things. So what were your thoughts if you were doing these exercises? Kind of thinking of yourself as a math student.
Not more
interesting.
I found myself caring about the answers more.
Yeah.
It's not just one math topic. It sort of integrates lots of different concepts from math, and you have to recall which to apply in the situation.
So let's do a little brainstorm. Which kind of key math ideas? So there's a learning theory, there's this great book, How People Learn, from the National Academy of Sciences, and they have three key principles. I see people nodding. Have you read that book, some of you? It's great, it's free online, How People Learn, and the three principles are: one, people come to a new situation with pre-existing knowledge, and for them to make sense of the new knowledge, it has to connect to their previous knowledge. Mm-hmm. So you want to try to think, you know, how does this new stuff connect to the previous? So one reason I asked you at the beginning, what do you know about sea ice, was to engage your memory and bring out of storage anything you might already know about sea ice, so you're kind of thinking about it, so you can make these connections to this new information. Then there's the idea that sometimes what you already understand has what's called misconceptions, naive understandings that worked well at a certain level, but now as we get to a more sophisticated way of thinking about it, I love this one, it's in physics. An object in motion will stay in motion. I have actually never seen an object in motion stay in motion. All my objects in motion stop. So we have real world experience that totally contradicts this abstract science idea. So it makes sense that that new idea of things just moving forever is hard to grasp and think, okay, well, I know that that's the answer on the test. But when I'm driving on ice, that's not the reality, and so I'm not going to worry about my car staying in motion. So that's actually one of the key learning difficulties, is this naive understanding we have from our life experience that gets in the way of learning and really incorporating these more complicated ideas. So number one is this previous knowledge. Number two, when they look at experts don't memorize a million factoids. They remember a few key ideas, and then they attach a lot of details to the key ideas. But they kind of first remember the key ideas and then the details. So chess masters, this is a great example, if you randomly put the pieces on the board, they don't remember the positions any better than a regular person. They only remember the position when it's in a scheme of a certain, you know, attack line or defense. So in this exercise, my point here is, what were kind of the key ideas, key mathematical ideas that we were engaging with in doing this problem?
Graphing and slopes.
Graphing, slopes.
Linear equations.
Linear equations.
Linear regression.
Linear regression.
Conversions
of units.
Conversion of units.
Yeah.
Using units. At what grade level do you first deal with lines or linear equations?
Linear equations?
Well, lines.
Lines.
I mean, you can do another line right at the beginning.
Well, like a line with a slope, not just like a flat line. Middle school, 6, 7, 8. So one could tone this down, maybe just give 2 data points. You know, here is the thing this year, here is it that year, come up with the line. But even without knowing anything about anything, people could draw that line and estimate, and if you make the graph longer, they can even predict when it's going to cross the line just by drawing it without any formulas. So I think partly this is a really rich example, and you can go in lots of different directions at different levels, like linear regression is kind of more sophisticated, maybe in a statistics course. You could do nonlinear regression of maybe it's actually a quadratic, or a other type of curve. And what's fun, I'll do a little bit with this, with Excel, how many of you use a spreadsheet for different things? How many of you have done data fitting with a spreadsheet? Okay, like as a math person, I didn't do that because we don't deal with data. But I've been learning, it's kind of fun. So right, to make a graph, you highlight these two. There you go. And so all this data, and I have like 3 or 4 other examples we won't get to, is from actual national labs, research centers. This is real data out there. It's not like dinky made up stuff from the math book. So with the internet, with this technology, one can give our students real data. One can have them go and find it. So really connecting the math of your lesson to real world data that they can then use. And I thought, wow, so cool. So you highlight that, right? Go up to chart, add trend line.
Oh yeah, you can, that's right. You can
options.
You can actually do nonlinear.
So there's our linear one. Or if we do, and then you can put options, display the equation, and type, say we do a quadratic. And there we have that, which looks like it's a better fit. So if we were to use the quadratic, and here's the equation for it, one could then predict, okay, with the quadratic fit, when will it become ice-free? And we talked of nonlinear feedbacks. That corresponds to a nonlinear function, a quadratic squared rather than a straight line, and things keep bending more and more, and that gets into graphing, convexity, concavity of graph. So, again, there are many different levels one can do this at, and using this data. Other thoughts people had if they were doing it? So here we see that it gets at key concepts. Let me ask you this idea of using math to predict the future. How many of you kind of knew that's what math is about? My guess is most of our students, particularly you know in K-12, don't realize that that's what math is about, or that it can be about that. And that's this idea of math modeling. We use the math to kind of make a model of the data. It's not exactly the data, and then we predict the future.
I think that's what modeling is about.
Modeling in general.
Math is about math.
Well, using the math to make
it is.
The model.
I mean,
well, no,
thinking about, I'm thinking about math and how most, you know, K-12 math is about what's already happened. You know, like most of your word problems are, you know, about what you already bought and what's left. And it's like, it's like all the past. It's almost never about the future.
Right. So, but, and again, the Common Core is putting a higher premium on students doing this math modeling. So that's kind of a fit here. Although I hear people say, yeah, that's in the Common Core and that's the part we skip. Mm-hmm. Because we know it's not going to be an out-of-state test, or it's too hard to do.
Or they're actually modeling things that have already happened. So it's like, why do you need to model it if the data, it's kind of weird. My son was just doing a test like that the other day. I was like, that's kind of modeling, but it's kind of the most boring kind of modeling.
Right.
Not that retrodiction isn't a form of prediction, because we do that all the time in evolutionary biology. So if you can predict what is happening, use what's happening now to predict what happened, where we came from in the past, it's the same general idea.
Right. And sometimes that helps you get your equations more accurate, and then you have more confidence in the future. So let me just mention that we have these other lessons that we don't have time to do. Maybe we'll talk about one of them a little bit. So for Math Awareness Month, I'll skip ahead to that. Every year, the math societies in the US, the American Math Society, which is kind of the research arm, the Math Association of America, which is college,
just
I mean, more teaching
like
focused.
Just think about it, once, 1 month out of the year.
The American Statistical Association and the Society for Applied and Industrial Mathematics, IAM, sponsor Math Awareness Month. Every year it's a different theme. This year it's Math and Magic in honor of Martin Gardner. Mm-hmm. And so at the website, there's a different video each month with some magic-y math thing. So somehow they heard about my work. I've done workshops with teachers for two summers on just math and sustainability. So they invited me to be the chairman of the planning committee. And I said, great. And when do we have, so this was like at the end of September or the end of August. And great, when is it? When it's in April? Oh, a year and a bit from now? No, next April. Oh, okay. Okay, and this committee, I'm the chairman of, who's on the committee? Oh, well, you get to make the committee. And when do you want the poster by? We're a little behind schedule, so maybe in a month. So, but on the other hand, if you're passionate about something and an opportunity comes about to make a change and have an impact, you jump at it. So this was not on my schedule of things I was going to do, but great, I'll do it. So I invited some colleagues. I knew Tom Path from Ithaca College, who in my mind is kind of the leader in this math and sustainability. A number of years ago, he started developing these modules with this real world data and doing workshops with faculty to get us realizing that as math teachers, we could connect our math to social issues. So he was on the committee and then a couple other people. So we made this poster and we ended up making this interactive version of the poster. So you click on any of the images, agriculture, what does that have to do with math and sustainability? We have a little mini essay here, and we link it to other things. The Gini coefficient, so now I'll go there. Anybody know what the Gini coefficient is?
That's the income inequality, right?
Income inequality. So this. Other types too. So the more, the closer that is to the y equals x line, the more evenly distributed money or income or whatever you're measuring is. And the more concave it is, then the more unequal. And we're probably at the most unequal time in American history right now, even a little more unequal than just before the Great Depression. So this is a measure of the social aspect of sustainability. And research has actually shown that when you have these big equities like we have now, you're more likely to have social unrest. So even the 1%ers, it's not actually in their interest to have these big disparities because maybe we'll have the revolution or society will kind of have its problems functioning as we're seeing when this is going on. So we have these essays.
Before the American Revolution, wasn't all the money in about 100 families and they had us fight Britain so we wouldn't fight them?
That's an interesting conspiracy theory.
Howard Zinn tells the story in the
people's history.
Yes.
Yeah. And then one thing I'm interested in is social networks and how things connect. So when we made this thing, you said, well, how does the Gini coefficient relate to the other pictures in the poster? So it's fishing cities. So the fishing. In my differential equations course, We look at population growth. People were talking about world population. So one can model population by the exponential function, but that predicts the population will go to infinity, which is unrealistic. So then we change the model to make it a little more sophisticated, where we have what's called the carrying capacity. And we say, well, we don't know exactly what it is, but conceptually, there's kind of a limit to how much a population can be, whether it's humans on the Earth or little microbes in a petri dish. And then one gets a kind of different equation. And so that's used in modeling fish populations down here. So population, right, that was world population, we hit on that one too. So there are these, this cool interactive poster. They're theme essays, and that was fun. I got to like recruit people to write these essays. And since I printed it all out, I'll just give you copies anyway, so you can read them. One is by a school energy manager. I wonder, school having an energy manager. And we'll just look at that one a little bit together. The other one, so there are a whole bunch of these essays. As a sports fan, the one I'm proudest of is Red Goes Green, the Philadelphia Phillies Sustainability Initiative. So our baseball team does a lot of sustainable things, and in figuring out what sustainable initiatives to do, they kind of use math to figure out, one, to keep track of how many gallons of frying oil from French fries and other things do they recycle into biofuel. How much electricity does the stadium use? And they do carbon offsets, so all the electricity they use in the stadium in the whole year is offset by wind power. So they're kind of an electric neutral thing. It's not that the wind, we have more wind power in Pennsylvania, it's not that our windmill electricity goes to the stadium, it goes into the whole grid, but we say, okay, I'm gonna pay extra for the wind energy to support the industry. And partly, like I found out there was a group of, I'm also now the director, the head of the Committee on Sustainability at Bryn Mawr College, like one thing leads into another. And so they have a sustainable director's roundtable. I'm not really the director. We're trying to get a director. Do you have a sustainability coordinator here?
No, but we're the committee. Well, I'm on the committee.
Oh, you're on the committee. Great.
And we have one person who's spending like 20% of her time kind of in a role like that, but she's in the job.
Yeah, that's our problem too. So I found out there was this group. I went to it, a couple meetings, and then one meeting was in the Philadelphia Philly Stadium, and the team was talking about what they did. And that was, I guess, just after I'd become chairman, so I went up and said, could you write an essay for our collection about how the Phillies are a sustainable organization, and you'll get this national recognition.
But there are externalities. I remember Carter changed daylight savings time, and one of his arguments was to send people home so the stadiums wouldn't have to waste all that electricity. Uh-huh. And they spent a lot more electricity at home lighting their house when they get home.
Okay. So yeah, maybe the most sustainable thing they could do would be to stop playing baseball or take trains when they go to a game in Los Angeles.
The daylight savings time is nobody's actually looked at the data.
Yeah.
So here they have nice
your
charts.
Your argument confuses the crops, right?
They do recycling of different things. Here's their green team. So here we have an essay from a school energy manager. So here we've been seeing kind of in a classroom how we could use topics of sustainability to teach key ideas, core concepts, meet standards, as well as hopefully get students more excited about math and help them, even in math class, learn about these really important issues facing the world. But the other piece was, well, what kind of projects could students do in the school or in the community, making use in some way of their math to help green places? So let's just do a brainstorm. You told me a bit about classes you've had on green things. We heard about the garden that the elementary school students made. So what might be other projects students could do, even at the college level, of something to do with sustainability? And maybe first think of a project they could do, and then we'll think how math could come into it, because I'm just sure math could come into anything. Yeah.
So I know of a student from my home state who did a science fair project estimating how much money and resources for ink is lost based on the font choices that the teachers made in his school. And he found out that if they switch from using Comic Sans and Times New Roman to some Garamond, which is a very thin thing, they would save like $30,000 a year. And you know, tons of resources as well.
Whoa.
So yeah, that was a pretty high
That's awesome. What a cool example.
Yeah, I just saw that in the news.
Yeah, Kansas City.
Others? Yeah.
Projects such as like looking at what is more sustainable, like hand dryers or paper towels, like because one costs obviously more money, uses more energy, but sort of what are the long-term effects, something like that.
Great, lots of math, kind of calculating these different things, comparing them. And it can be tricky, like, how do you figure out every little bit that goes into it? Do they call these life cradle to
lifetime,
brain?
Yeah,
lifetime calculations.
Well, I was just going to say, you can do that with dietary choices, like, you know, how much energy is saved just by having, you know, meatless Monday or something like that. So, but you can't call it that. You have to call it, like,
and that's where you need to partner with your maybe English or you know creative writing department or management and think of the right ways to do that. Like we're losing a South Carolina every year rather than we're losing 82,000 square kilometers. Did you have an idea?
Well, this is the college level. I recently heard about a startup at Columbia in the MBA program that's people that are finding the optimal level of gasoline per airplanes. It's like a big data analysis. That's obviously higher level, but this idea of using math to find optimal levels for.
Right, so they're not like overfueled.
Don't fill it.
Right? Because if it's overfueled, then you're flying a lot of fuel around.
Exactly.
Yeah. Uh-huh. But if you're underfueled,
you don't want to make a decimal point. How about other things kind of in college life, this idea of kind of comparing, you know, alternatives? Well, what are some things in your everyday college life that could relate to sustainability and one could kind of calculate and decide whether to do A or B?
Okay, so this has nothing to do with my everyday college life. I had this little pet project that I'm researching, and I don't know if I'll ever get it off the ground, but I do live in a private home, and I have a garden, a backyard, and my next thing that I want to try to do is raise chickens. So I want to do like some backyard chicken coops, and I've done a lot of, you know, reading about how, you know, they can produce the eggs, and then, you know, they also eat the bugs in your garden, and you can, and then you can compost, and just all kinds of stuff, like it's really good. For like, if I really want to have like a
yeah, except there's a guy at Brooklyn College who has, and again, he's used the data and kind of done the math and shown that in at least if you're in Brooklyn and you do that, that you're going to be feeding yourself an enormous amount of lead and other toxic soil contaminants because you can't yeah.
Oh, because they're eating the insects that are coming from the soil, and the soil has a lot of lead in it from the gasoline.
And there's a constant redeposition. Even if you clean the soil, there's a constant redeposition of lead
interesting.
In the atmosphere, and it bioaccumulates.
Well, there goes my answer.
But you don't live in the city.
No, but I still, I live in the suburbs, yes. But, that's interesting.
Well, composting. That was one we, my math students looked at. Do you guys do composting?
I have something that I have to do once, and this was because this guy who teaches in the English department, he teaches screenwriting here, and I met him at a party, it had nothing to do with Barnard, but he said that he wanted to know how many coffee cups are used per year and like convert that to trees. And I was so intrigued by it that I did a little calculation, and it's like one person uses like a tenth of a tree or something. If you have a coffee cup every day, it's kind of scary. So.
We have like a minimal compost here, but we have a fire digester in our dining hall, which is
that's why
different in the sense that it takes, like, we can't put in certain things like the compost. And it uses, it uses energy to essentially like take all the products and it like becomes water and it just like goes back into the system. So like
interested in, just sort of like which one's actually more efficient or better. Mm-hmm.
Composting or bio?
Bio digestion.
So I did put solar on my roof, and it was not a break-even proposition. I believe in spending money to cause changes like that.
Uh-huh.
But it's basically bull to have the peasants of the world do good behavior and feel virtuous what they're doing. The only thing that's meaningful is political action. So in California, there's a drought, and Governor Brown is telling you not to flush unless it's solids. Meanwhile, 80% of the measurable water is going on agriculture, not to houses. And that's just the measurable water. Most of the water is groundwater that's being pumped up because you own land. And it's this guns rights thing. You're not going to meter the water I pump out of my ground, but everyone's over pumping and the water's dropping.
And maybe that's the deeper level. So another thing that got me interested in all of this is a great book called Sustainable Energy Without the Hot Air by our Cambridge physicist, McKay. And it's, again, online free. And it uses kind of high school math, and maybe there are a few sections that are a little more advanced on sustainable energy without the hot air. And it looks at this issue of what do the numbers really tell us? We get information like, we have a new solar plant. The Phillies helped build the largest solar plant in Pennsylvania out in Lancaster County. Here's part of it. And we say, this is enough solar energy for 10,000 homes for a year. Well, that sounds kind of good, but you know, what does that really mean when we think of, well, how many solar panels or how many South Carolinas of solar panels would we need to produce 30% of the electricity that we use in the United States? What was your example there? Yeah, with the water, you know, is it really going to make a difference for us to only flush once in a while? And these are kind of important issues, because
what are you flushing? It's nothing else. It's just keeping the masses down so they don't get uppity and go into revolt.
And what are we going to put our time into to make it? Because these are serious problems the world is facing. And if we run down the wrong line, doing something like, there's a lot of work, my students are very interested in takeout and the plastic styrofoamy container that they use. So is that really, an important issue in terms of impact, or is there some other thing?
Building another coal-fired power plant, you know, is a huge issue that you can actually stop through political action.
Right.
That would just, you know, make much more of a difference if you're worried about sort of atmospheric damage from styrofoam.
And all of our waste by law in our county has to go to an incinerator. None of it goes to landfill. And although, you know, it's not great, the styrofoam actually makes less pollutants because it burns more cleanly than other things that one could make a carry-out container out of. So from certain perspectives, it's actually better to use the styrofoam than some of the alternatives.
And it doesn't cost as much money to, like, truck it in. There's a lot of
energy.
Yeah.
So part of this is like, what do the numbers say? And it's important to know so we put our energy in the things that will make a difference.
I don't know about styrofoam. One night when I couldn't sleep, I was watching television and there was some movie on that I've never found again about the production of vinyl siding for homes.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like the real harm be that the harm is actually in the production of it. It's not in putting it on your house, but it's killing the people who work in the factories who make it. And then that would be my question about something like styrofoam. What's the harm to the people in the locale where it's made?
Well, that's the whole issue, you know, with China and the soil. Also in India, like part one of the most terrible pollutants are dyes for fabric. And so I was just reading today about there's this new fabric, it's called Morphotex, which they've basically taken the blue Morpho butterfly, and through nanotechnology, like layers of fabric that have no dye in it, it's completely dye-free, but it can look red, blue, or green. But you could eliminate all the dyes,
yeah.
A couple projects my students work on. One was composting, to try to figure out is it really an ecologically good thing to do composting. The original company that Bryn Mawr hired came from Wilmington, Delaware. So three times a week, they would drive 30 miles each way to pick up the compost and take it back. And so is the benefit from the composting outweighing this fossil fuel pollution CO2 thing? The new company we have is much closer. And so we decided it was actually a good thing, and now we're doing a lot of composting. Another project was, do you guys have trays in your dining hall?
Trays?
Yeah. We no longer have trays. Some of my math students did a study, and they estimated it costs about 5 cents to wash a tray with soap and hot water. And so when you add up how many trays there are in a year, which is a lot in our dining hall, we have 1,200 students. How many does Barnard have?
About 2,200.
Oh, so yours might be almost twice that, so maybe you spend. So we spend, the estimate and was $30,000 a year on washing trays. So you're maybe $50,000.
So what do they use for sleds now?
I was sledding, that's unfortunate. Well, less broken ankles, but less fun. They do have trays for people who need them, but also they found, and they measured it a bit, that if you have a tray, you're more likely to like put a lot on and waste food. I think our students, and maybe at Barnard too, as women, you're less likely to be taking huge helpings than guys might. But they did a weighing as part of their math study. One day they had a big trash can and you put all of your leftovers when they had trays and one day without, and they found that there was some savings in food waste. I mean, the best thing would just be to not have food waste so that we don't have compost anyway, but that happened. Another project was our admissions process. Over time, you know, people do electronic admissions. 98% of admissions to Bryn Mawr comes in electronically. A few still are paper. And then 100% of that all gets reprinted out and put into paper folders. So we print 150,000 pieces of paper in the admissions process.
That's crazy.
Did you think it was
too?
And so they were looking into, and it was good timing that exactly when I was teaching this course, the admissions people were doing a study of the cost benefit of switching for $200,000 to an electronic admission system and an electronic financial aid. Because in the old way, you had the folder, it got sent over by hand to the financial aid office. And then later it got sent by hand to the dean's office. And you'd have two copies of it. There'd be the one at the dean's office when students came to Bryn Mawr. And then in the basement, there were shelves and shelves of these old folders that had to be kept for 10 years. So the students worked with the admissions people. They did that analysis. They found that if we rented out the space in the basement that's used for storing all these old files for, like, you know, the local price of these little storage cabinets, that in itself, after a couple of years, would pay for the conversion cost. Then there was the tree cost and the paper. And then there's something that's hard to quantify in a math model, the human stress, having these admissions officers reading these, you know, piles of folders, and if they lose a paper ever, it's hours to re-find it and refile it. And then people need the folder at the same time.
You do a better job of admissions if you do it on a screen. Mm-hmm.
So it was very interesting when there are things that are not easy to quantify, this human element, the social element, the kind of social justice element of the damage to the workers, that maybe in just the cost benefit, the math loses track, but that actually are key factors. So we now have this electronic system. I think because of all the problems in the Common App, they were leery of using it this first year, but that was something my students did. Another one, where I live, they were about to build a new recreation and environmental education center. This was like a 10-year project. There was a state hospital that got closed, the community took over. And they wondered, well, what about putting alternative energy in? And so the students took on that project, and they decided that solar couldn't work, wind wouldn't be so good where we live, but that a geothermal system, where you pump up the 50-degree temperature of the ground into liquid and you use that to help heat in the winter and cool in the summer, would save $50,000 a year in energy costs. It would cost an extra $600,000, though, to install it.
Right.
Is it worth doing?
I looked at doing that in my house.
So $50,000 a year versus $600,000. 12 years. This center is going to last at least 25 years. That's the lifetime of these heating systems. So it would actually save millions of dollars for the community. And our kind of conservative councillors voted unanimously to put it in. One of the councillors said this is a historic day for Haverford Township when we do something forward thinking that's going to cost us money in the short term and save us money in the long term. So the students were very excited about being able to use their math to leave a lasting impact both on the community and on Bryn Mawr through their actions. In that handout about the school, it's what can the students do, and one big one is saving energy. So how can students save energy? Well, you can turn out the lights. You talked to Meet This Monday. In this school, they have cold lunch Fridays, where on Fridays, you don't turn on the convection oven in the cafeteria. All the food is cold, so you save all the energy from that. Another one, and this is getting at the power of students in educational institutions, and is the hopeful, optimistic endpoint of the lesson rather than the gloom and doom that we don't want to leave our students with. They came up with the idea that in between classes, we can turn off the lights in the hallway and just have the emergency lights on because nobody's walking. And as soon as school is over at 2:30, we can turn off those lights. Now the teachers, if they stay late in their room, when they walk out the building, there's only going to be the emergency lights, and that might be a bit inconvenient. But because the students proposed that, and it wasn't the principal or the superintendent, the teachers went along with it. So this school district in Pennsylvania has, with the ideas of the students, in partnership with the teachers, done a lot of initiatives. And look at your graph.
Why didn't they use motion sensors with a 5-minute hysteresis?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are things about that for some reason. So we have that in some of our classrooms, too.
And then I sit at the dining table in my church.
Okay, so here maybe this will be my final little bit to end. How much money has the school district saved per year once it kicked into high gear these conservation efforts? Both, part of it is just being more careful about your facilities. It turns out that an auditorium that my kid's school holds 800 people. You have to engineer it so if 800 people are there, each producing, who knew that the human body produces like 100 watts? It's like a 100 watt light bulb running. So with 800 people, that's a lot of heat, and you have to have the air conditioning to handle that. However, when it's empty, you don't want that air conditioning system running for no reason. So part of it is just like paying attention to things and turning off the air handling unit if nobody is in the auditorium. So do you want to...
temperature feedback? What kind of air conditioning are you talking about?
Well, you know, right, you can put it on the timer. There are all kinds of automatic things you can do. Maybe you have that or don't. But even if you have an automatic thing, you have to set it. Our home energy control, fortunately, I'm married to a really smart woman.
Engineers. Smart about that.
And she sets it. Right, we need engineers who can make things that are usable.
But Barnard has already done that because we signed this pledge with the city that we're going to reduce carbon by a certain amount across a certain rate. And the first half was like smashing success. I mean, we totally met the first half of the pledge because, like you said, it was actually kind of easy. But the challenge will be meeting the next half. You know, that's where it requires more attention, possibly more capital investment, you know, more sacrifice and whatever, so.
Here he had a nice graph showing something over the weekend where Sunday afternoon they started using a lot of power. And that was because they were turning on some system on Sunday afternoon when the custodian person was there and getting set to leave for the night. And once they realized that, they automated it, and then it turned on like at 5 a.m. on Monday morning rather than the night before, and they saved. $1,500 a year. But that adds up over time. So how much did the district save per year by their initiatives?
And that's every year?
That's every year. So $2.1 million versus $3.7 million. So that's $1.6 million. This is one of the largest school districts. It has 16 buildings. But we're talking some real money there. Mm-hmm. And so people, when they find out I'm in math and sustainability, they say, well, what's math got to do with sustainability? You know, environmental science, biology, graphs, data, numbers, predictions. How can you do sustainability without math? So I think that's all right.
Awesome. Thanks.
Oh, yes.
These are environmental hazards.
There's a type of teaching called problem-based learning, where you have the material you want to teach, but rather than like just teaching it, you put it in the context of an interesting question. So the question is it worth it changing light bulbs from the old-fashioned incandescent, which uses 75 watts, to the compact fluorescent light bulb? How many people have compact fluorescents in their houses?
If you break one, you should just move out.
Well, what's the problem?
Mercury.
Mercury, there's mercury in it. But rather than using 75 watts of light, of energy, it uses 18.3. So this is my watt meter, 18.3. And then there's the new LED. How many people have an LED light?
My entire house, four houses.
Oh my God, terrific. So this is the $10 million light bulb. There's these X prizes, like for the first reusable spaceship. So there was one to create the first LED bulb that did all these great things. And this is what it is. It looks like ridiculously fancy because it cost $80. Originally. It's coming down. And it uses 16 watts. So not a whole lot less than the compact fluorescent. So the question is it worth it to change light bulbs? If you gotta go buy some new light bulbs, well, it's hard to buy the incandescent, but do you buy the compact fluorescent or the LED?
Well, it depends on how long they last.
So let's do a quick brainstorm. What factors would go into it? How long they last? How much energy they use.
How likely you are to break it.
Yeah.
How much they cost originally.
How much light they actually throw.
Whether you can stand living in a room with that light.
Yes.
Which light? This light?
The fluorescent light sucks.
Yes.
Oh, what's so bad about it?
It's just bad spectrum. It looks like you're in some grim institutional setting, whereas the best LEDs are as good as any incandescent in terms of the quality of the light.
They're more like daylight.
Depends which one you buy.
And these ones, after a couple of years, they last a long time. They last maybe half as long as those.
Well, the other problem with those is that they take a while to warm up. So when you first turn them on,
it's
annoying because it's very dim.
It's like totally dim. So you might like break your leg in the middle of the night.
Or no one can see the board for the first 5 minutes of lecture.
These have, you said, lead in them.
No, mercury.
Mercury, sorry.
One of those heavy metals.
Well, right. My wife's a chemist. Some bad thing. What other things that maybe are less quantitative might go into deciding which one to use?
They look stupid.
Right? Absolutely, aesthetic.
I look beautiful in certain kind of lighting, or not less beautiful in others.
Right, like your decor, the decor.
The decor, does it fit in the bulb?
These don't break.
How easy is it to buy?
How easy is it to buy? How are you changing the light bulbs? Is it like at Bryn Mawr? How many of you have ever visited Bryn Mawr? A few of you. We have the Thomas Great Hall, which is in the National Historic Register from like 1885. Used to be the library. There's beautiful chandeliers there, and with the old light bulbs, after about 2 months, some light bulb would burn out, and then after a number of them would burn out, you would come in. Now you can't even reach it with a ladder. You need a lift, so it'd be a huge operation to change the light bulbs. Jokes about how many people it takes to change a light bulb. So we put in LEDs. We are now more than a year and a half without any of the LEDs burning out. So if you don't want to have to change light bulbs because it's like hard, then
Well, and also how likely is some poor electrician's assistant to electrocute himself while you're changing this? Because that happened at the University of Wisconsin. They put in energy efficient lighting and they hired non-union contractors to do it, and a guy actually died.
because he was careless and he electrocuted himself. So again, getting back to sort of social justice has to be factored into it. So.
And here's an interesting little math problem. How much does it cost to change a light bulb at Bryn Mawr College?
Who?
Let's think about this.
I don't
Who
know,
has
but
to be involved? Who has to be involved from get-go to end in somebody, there's a light that's burned out?
You have to put in a work order. Jerry has to come to your office. Check what kind of light bulb it is.
So that's 10 minutes with professor's time, and they're pretty well.
And Jerry's and time. Then, yeah.
Somebody has to order a light bulb. It has to come to receiving and be put on the shelf. Somebody else has to take it off the shelf and go put it in. You probably need two people because somebody has to hold the ladder.
And if you're not reading yourself off of paper, you actually don't need the light as bad because your screen is actually self-lit. So, see, there's another reason to go paperless.
So what's dumb about this design?
It doesn't look like a light bulb.
It's got 110 going into every damn bulb. There's a transformer in here per bulb. This is what it should look like. This takes 12 volts in the back. When we build our new building at Barnard, we should have a separate wiring system for DC 12 or DC 24.
Oh yeah, like SOM is really gonna factor that in.
They should.
How many of you know how an LED works? An expert here. What does LED stand for?
Light emitting disaster.
Diodes. These little yellow things, these squares are the diodes. Watch your eyes, it gets bright, but look at how it makes its light. Those little diodes heat up, or they don't heat up that much, actually.
Yeah.
Part of this lab is we have this temperature gauge.
It's not producing a lot of heat.
No, right. But if you put under cabinet lighting in your kitchen, your stuff
gets
foils on that shelf.
250 degrees, the incandescent. So you kind of see where all the energy is wasted in the heat. So this actually, when I work with the teachers, we begin our two-week institute with the question, is it worth it to change light bulbs? And we spend days looking at all the costs. Then there's the carbon footprint. Nobody thinks about that at the beginning. So you can build in lots of things with a rich kind of question. And the second essay by the light bulb designer.
And is it made in the United States or not? And is it made by union labor?
So the fellow who wrote the second essay is a light bulb designer and a friend of our facilities director. And he's made new types of light bulbs. And our facilities people said, oh, well, the one you have isn't quite right. If you change it this way and that way, it can fit in the existing cans, and we can just very easily take out the old lights and put in the new LEDs. So he made one that our facilities people tested, and it worked well. So a year ago in the winter, we renovated the dorm, we made it all LED, and we had the first 50 copies of this brand new light that he designed, which they expect to sell to hundreds of thousands around the country because it's the perfect replacement.
One of those of that exact brand was recalled because the transformers caught fire. That's I've been afraid of posies at Barnard because I don't want to be responsible for one of our buildings burning down. If we did DC, it wouldn't work that way.
So this was kind of the reverse of the social justice of people being misused. It was that we have experts in our staff in many kinds of areas, and this really gave them an opportunity to use their expertise and make a positive contribution. So we had a ceremony where our president came and turned on the light switch to inaugurate the new building. We gave certificates of merit to our electricians for their above and beyond duty work in helping to design this new light bulb. And this designer came and gave a talk about how 20 years of different career paths led to him now becoming this innovative entrepreneur, light bulb designer, who started his career by being arrested with Martin Sheen protesting nuclear power plants. And what this issue of what action has made the biggest impact? Was it kind of that protesting or becoming an expert in this field and creating these new light bulbs that now can save all this energy? And how you're better off not following the straight and narrow, because it actually was this mixture of all of his experiences that led him do what he did.
Thank you.
Cool.
Thank you.